So good morning everyone, welcome to lecture 12 of Introduction to Programming. So we have seen, I believe in the previous lecture we have seen struct and typedef, and we'll look into some more aspects regarding that and also look at a couple of more ideas, and then next week onwards we'll start with pointers. So just like we have struct, there is another type constructor called a union, which is also, so this union is a keyword, and then let me give it name float or int. So this is the name that I am giving, and so it has float f, it has int I. Okay, and now let me just do a typedef on this. Okay, so this looks very similar to what struct is, but the difference is in the set of values that is available over here. So in a union can have multiple members, but the amount of space required for a union, for object of this type, is at most whichever is the largest object that requires. So at a time you can either access a float or an int. If you try to do both, you know, weird things can happen. So first of all, let's understand that where does this word come from. Little bit of theory. So when I do a struct, right, struct and some type, and then I'll say int I, and then float. Float f. So as far as the set of values is concerned for this particular type struct s, the set of values is what? The set of value is coming from int cross float. So I'm just using the overloaded notation. So int, I'm assuming that basically you know that this is a set. You know that this is a set of values of int, set of values of float, and the value of this particular thing is int cross float. You can think of it like a set cross product of two sets, right? So so if this is 32 bit, right, and if this is also 32 bit, then how many total values are possible? I mean, approximately you can say that, you know, these many bit patterns, so that means that 2 power 32 cross, and this cross is actually for multiplication, so it is going to be 2 power 64. And mostly, so let's assume for a moment, so this is a 4 byte and this is 4 byte, so the space required for storing one variable of this particular type, so then let me just do s underscore t, and then if I have a declaration, you know, struct type s, then this, then how many number of bytes does it require to store this? I mean, for this variable, how many number of bytes are required in the memory? It will be 8 bytes, right? So 4 plus 4. Because these are non-overlapping, certainly non-overlapping memory is required. 4 byte this, 4 byte this, and they cannot overlap. Now in a union, if you do a union, then in a union what happens is, let's say that you declare like this, Then for a union, if this is 4 bytes and this is 4 byte, and you declare a variable of this particular type, the number of bytes required is only 4, because at any given time you should access only either this, only either integer or float. And I think that, see, now it should be very easy and intuitive to understand that why it is called union, because it is nothing but it is a set union. I hope all of you are familiar with set union. So the set of values of int, union the set of values of float. So these are the set of values that that are available over here. So number of values that are available, so that is why this is called a union. Union still defines a new type, by the way, just like struct. So the moment you wrap something around a union, two types become incompatible even though they have the same members. And there are very few cases where this union has a legitimate use. Many times in embedded system people might use it, because as you can see that the amount is required for this is very less, right? So I mean, you can think of that basically, you know, let's say that a user specifies that do I want to operate on integer or do I want to operate on float, and based on that, if the user says that okay, I want to operate on integer, then you can just use whatever, so u.i, and just keep using this as integer. If let's say, you know, you want to operate something as float, then you can just keep using this one. You should not use both. And the reason is that essentially what happens is that if you do a write, you say u.i is equal to 5, it is going to write the bit pattern in int whatever, you know, represents number 5. And then if you try to read it, you know, for some another variable u.f, it is just going to, you know, read whatever this bit pattern indicates in float. So it is kind of very dangerous. It is type unsafe to do this thing, that, you know, you write something as int and then you are reading as float. See, this is it is not even a type conversion, by the way. So when you have a variable, so let's say that, you know, variable int of I'll just call it i1 is equal to 5, and then let's say I say that float f is equal to i1. What happens is that this integer value is converted to float. So you, by now you know that the bit pattern, the way these guys are represented. So for example, float will have mantissa bit, exponent bit, sine bit, and all of these we know by now. If you don't know, let's refer to, you know, lecture 3 and the supplement. So please refer to that. So there are two videos on just these floating point things. But this is not even a conversion. You are just reading whatever the bit pattern was here, and this is very dangerous. So in C++, in modern C++, they have introduced as an alternative to this something called std colon colon variant. I won't go into that, but this is just because some of the students who knows C++, they should use this instead of a union. So what it ensures is that if you are using it as int, you continue to use it as int, otherwise you continue to use it at float. So it kind of helps in more type safe way of doing using a union. And the reason why it is required, because it requires less amount of space. So especially, you know, when people program for embedded system or low level, where this is of important, you can use union. Otherwise, for most of the applications that you are going to write, you will not require a union. Right. And now you also understand that why it is called a union, because it is a set union, it is nothing else. And you can have multiple fields. So what you can have is the union can have fill int I and float let's say double and let's say you can have multiple members. The amount of space that it is going to occupy, it is just so if this, since this is 8 byte, this is 1 byte, this is 4 byte, and this is also typically 4 bytes. So the amount of space required is only this much, right? And I hope that you know, you also understand that that means that you know, this is pointless, that you know, int I and also have another int j inside a union. So pointless in the sense that you know, both are int and they are not a different one. The only difference where you might want to do that for readability, that where actually this member actually stands for something else, and this stands for, you want it to stand for something else. So even though both are int, but you just want to convey that maybe you know, let's say that one is a, so let's say that you want to do something like height. So height can be measured in centimeter or in inch or in millimeter, let's say. And now you just want to, through some you know, documentation or in source documentation, means that you know, you want to convey a variable that okay, you know what, I just and the user can choose that whether you want to represent the units in centimeter, inch or mm. I'm assuming that they are all, you know, you want to represent only in integral values. Then you can say that okay, unsigned cm, in, mm kind of a thing. So all three are unsigned, but it's just that you know, through this use of nice variables names, you are conveying that okay, so in throughout my program I'll use only inches, or if for some reason you want to say that no, you know, you want to use centimeter. But please try to understand that you know, if you write this value as one of the variable and then read it as a different variable, etc., there is no type conversion taking place. You are just reading the bit pattern, and the behavior is kind of undefined as to you know, what that bit pattern might be and how it is going to work. Okay, so let's you know, see this in action. I am hoping that because so float int, and so for example arrays, right? So arrays are homogeneous of nature, so they store variables of the same type. So you can say that int array 100, that means that all 100 are int. You don't have that, you know what, I want some of the elements to be float, I want some of the element to be int, etc. But if you want to do that, you can do that via union, where you can actually declare an array of this particular type. So you can say that okay, some elements are int, some are float, things like that. Okay, so let's try to do this, right? So let me just declare an array of this type. So let's say that it is array of size 10, and so now you want to initialize this value. So I'll say that okay, all the even ones, so all the even numbers, that means that if even indices, so I'll just check the last bit of this index, and if the last bit is 0, then I know that it is even. So if it is even, then let's say that you are using integer, So I'm going to use this, then this is equal to this number, else I say, did I make a mistake somewhere? Hold on a second. I think just to be sure, I'll just have extra parentheses and braces, just so that mistake. And otherwise, if it is odd, then I want to use the float version of this. So I'll say whatever, i plus 0.5. And then similarly, so I mean, once I initialize this, I want to print it. So first I'll just print the index, and then let's print the element. And yeah, here this is going to be float. Okay, that's fortunate for us. That essentially 0 is 0. And for 1 it is, you know, 1 plus 0.5, so it is 1.5, 2.5 and things like that. Now, as I have told you, right, that basically, you know, if you write it as a float, and then if you try to read it as int, then what will happen, we don't know. We don't know that how it's going to look like. So let me just try to do this. That now the same index, you remember that this I had written as int. But now I am trying to read it as float, that value, and trying to print. And I don't know now how it's going to look like. So as you can see that for this value 2, so this is a, so 2 is 2. But when you try to read it as this thing, it is coming out as 0.00. So it will just, you know, take the whatever the bit pattern, and we don't know that how it's going to come out to be. Right, so that is one problem. So the correct usage of union is always that the moment you start using it, so you decide first of all that, you know, which of these members you want to use it. And then just continue using only that member, or in between you can switch mode, but essentially you try to remember that do not try to write as one type and then try to read it as another type. That is certainly very unsafe. So that is the, you know, correct way to use union. Also, as I told you that you know, the, so let's look at the size that this takes. So I'll say float f int I, and I do a type ref on this. And you will see that the size required for these two will be different. Okay, so let me just now we don't have to print this, or this is fine. So let me declare something of, so float and int t as fi. And I can initialize it as well, because, you know, one is float and one is int. The first one is float, so I'll just write, let's say 0.2 and 3. That doesn't matter. And now let me just try to print the size of both of these guys. size of struct in here. Let's see that, you know, how much space does it require. So first is size of struct. So in the size of, you can either specify the object or the variable of that particular type, or you can just directly write the type itself. And we anyway have so I'll just take the first element of the union, and I think that this should work. As predicted, right? So size of struct and union, so size of struct is 8, it is in the number of bytes, and the size of union is 4, which is also in the number of bytes. So as you can see over here, that so this is 4 byte and this is 4 byte, so it's 4 plus 4 because it's a non-overlap. And here both of this just share the space. So at any phase of computation, you only should use one of them at a time. Now there is another aspect also that is called a padding. So what might happen is that in your memory, things have to be aligned as a multiple of things might have to be aligned as a multiple of something. Some number depends on its architecture dependent. So what might happen is that the size of the composite type, which is this struct, that size can be more than the summation of each individual component. Can be more than the summation. So for example, character requires, let's say, 1 byte, and int is 4 byte, and this is 4 byte. So one would assume that this would be 9, but it could be more than 9, right? Let's see what it prints. So as you can see that for struct, it said that it is actually 12 bytes, not 9, it is 12. So what happened? What happened was that everything in, for example, in this particular machine is, was aligned at, you know, that's a minimum 4 bytes. So if that is your, and this portion that, you know, how the alignment takes place in multiple of what, it is kind of architecture dependent. So that padding might happen, because if somebody wants to read care, and it is not that, you know, you can just read this particular thing, you can have minimum 4 byte allocation is there for a, you know. So again, these are the same concept, basically the difference between a word. So one word can be multiple of bytes, and then the architecture might have a different word size, and things have to be aligned with respect to that. So as you can see that instead of the size being 9, the size is always, you know, it can be padded. So some extra space can be given for this, which you cannot directly access. So you can access things only within these members, as you can see over here. But that is also another lesson. And then when we look at the dynamic memory allocation, that you should never manually calculate the size of any such compound type and then do the memory allocation. You should always use size of operator, so that at runtime your program can allocate appropriate size. Because if you manually calculate, you are bound to make mistake, and then things can go wrong. Since we haven't talked about dynamic memory allocation, because for that I need to talk about pointers, so I'm not going to talk about it right now. And for union, the size was 4, because as I said that it will take whichever is the largest, whatever is the largest. So in the union, this is 1 byte, this is 4 byte 4 byte, so it will say 4 byte. Now I can always say that, you know, so this is going to be 8 byte, in which case the size is going to be 8 bytes. Compile, and run, and you can see that now the size of the union has increased to 8 byte. Whichever is the largest member. I can even have array inside this. So you can have this, in which case the size is going to be what for each union variable, it is going to be 10 cross 8, which is 80 byte. And so it is now, the size required is 80 bytes. Okay, so this is one aspect regarding, so struct and un, rest everything is the same. The difference is that this is a non-overlapping memory. So the set of values is essentially cross product of every, values that every member can take, whereas in union, it is just a union. That's why it is called a union. It is set union that, you know, either the value is this or this or this or this, whichever. I'm assuming that is why it is called union. It's just a speculation. One has to read the history of C, whether that is correct or not. Now we know that at some point in time, you know, we had written this program for factorial using recursion, right? Now imagine that this is something that that you have any computation for which, you know, the computing that value is very expensive. So assume that factorial of a given number is very expensive to compute. So the next time when you want to, you know, require the same value, instead of computing, you can say that, you know what, see, if the factorial of 5 is 120, we already know it, let's not bother computing again. So this is technique that is many times use of remembering the already computed value. Eventually, you know, when you learn algorithms, you will learn this in the dynamic programming, often uses this this trick, but it has, you know, if not used correctly, it can create problems, right? So now let's talk about, I'll create something called I don't know whether 20 factorial can be part of this, but let's say 10. I'm hoping that till 10 factorial this is not going to overflow. So what I did over here, you see that this is a declaration, but this is not part of any function, right? So this is in the global scope and global lifetime. So essentially this variable can be accessed by any function. Now see, try to understand that things like this, you should rarely use it, global variables, as much as possible avoid it, because most of you will get it wrong, and this can create a lot of safety issues, introducing variables in the global, introducing global variables, right? There are two reasons I am showing you. One is that, you know, there are sometimes legitimate use of it, and second is for completeness. That okay, so this is now, the variable is declared in the global scope, and these are called global variables. And now what I can do that, so in fact I'll just, let me just write that this this is a functional factorial. So in some sense this is a mathematical function. Okay, and let me write another version of the same factorial, but, you know, factorial with side effect, or factorial with caching. So caching is nothing but basically, you know, for now you can assume that it means remembering the already computed value. So if I already know the factorial, so let's assume that if basically let's say that this is 0, that means that I don't know the value yet. I haven't computed the value yet. So factorial of this particular number, if I have not computed, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to compute it. So now how do I compute it? I'll just make a recursive call. So first I'll compute the result, and once I compute the result, now I know that this result is indeed a factorial of this particular number. So I want to update my cache. So I'll update the cache, and then I'm going to just so what I'm doing is that if I already don't know the result is not in my cache, then what I'm going to do is I'll compute it, but once I compute it, now I know the result. So now it is here. Else. So now I know that, you know, there is already some result is there in my cache. So I'll just say that, you know, return. So 0 indicates that, you know, I haven't computed, because since it is unsigned and factorial of 0 is also 1. So 0 is never a legitimate value of factorial of anything. So since, you know, I want to sort of print this thing, that, you know, this is whether it is coming from memory or whether it is computing. So let me just print it, just so that, you know, we know that. In fact, see, I think that I'm sure that, you know, many times what you use is that you use printing for debugging. So you can use this preprocessor macro like this. So whenever you compute new line, this is what is going to be printed. If it is coming from main memory, I want to print that it is coming from the memory. I mean, I'm not computing the value again, right? And say again num and fact cache. This does not have a side effect, and that's why the first one, the fact functional, behaves like a mathematical function. Second is not a mathematical function. Right, now let's try to invoke this from main and then compute a value, and we'll see. So since there is already a print statement anyway, whenever it is going to compute, so I'm not going to have a separate print over here. But see, this caching helps only in the same invocation of the program. If I run the program again, it's not like this cache is already there, right? I have to do it again. So let me do it. I think let me do it in a loop. Okay, I'm intentionally writing an infinite loop. You should not do this. I'll kill the loop whenever I'm sort of tired of it. And yes, it will result. So there is another thing that, see, this function fact with caching, it returns a value, right? Unsigned long long, but I am discarding this value because I am not storing it in any variable. So only if I define this debug macro, then it will print. Otherwise, it won't print. In fact, see, the interesting thing to notice is that, you know, without this, it was not even compiling this portion, right? That's why it wasn't given warning. So the preprocessor discards it if this macro is not defined. So now that I have done it, let me show you. So let's compute factorial of 2. Yeah, so you remember that I think that, you know, we should initialize. Yeah, this was missing, because without which, so just like we have a terminating condition over here, I mean, we are not in the fact with caching, we are not really sort of computing this. Okay, so we should do this. So fact of 0 is 1, and now this should work, I'm hoping. Okay, so you see that, see the order of printing, we'll see that first it says that returning already computed value of factorial of 0 is equal to 1. Why did that happen? Because we have already initialized that value. And since we have initialized value for factorial of 0, that factorial of 0 is 1. So when it comes, so first time what is happening is that it is trying to calculate. So initially, apart from the first element for index 0, all other elements are 0. Why they are 0? Because it is declared in a global scope, and as per the standard this will be 0 initialized. So this over here will make a recursive call. So let's say that it will, num will be 2, it will make a recursive call, the num will be 1, it will make a recursive call, num will be 0, and then fact cache 0 is not 0, it is what? It is actually 1. So it is going to print this. So that's why it is saying that, you know, returning the already computed value of factorial of 0, which is 1. And then, you know, this is what we know. But now we know that now the values are computed for factorial of 0, factorial of 1, factorial of 2. These values are already computed. Now, if I compute factorial of 4, you realize that since factorial of 2 is already computed, it is not computing it again, it is just returning it this value from the cache, right? And now the factorial of 3 and 4 is also computed, right? So now if I ask for 3, it is just going to say that, you know what, I already know, I don't have to compute anything. I ask for 6, then it will only go till 4 because all the others are already computed, like factorial of 4 is computed. So the few things are that are happening, right? So one concept that we have introduced is that you can declare variable in the global scope. They are called global variable, and most of the time they are very, very bad. Should not use it. Okay. And the second thing that I wanted to exemplify, I wanted to give an example that this, there are two versions, right? So what are these two versions that we had written? One was fact functional. You see that fact functional, whenever you provide a value, right? So it's a mathematical function, it will just return the n factorial. And now you will see that, okay, the factorial with cache, that when you provide value of this thing, it is also returning n factorial, right? So you see that if you think of this function as a box, so fact functional, you provide a value of n and it returns a value of n. So the only way this function is communicating with outside world, when I say outside world means everything that is outside of this function, the only way it is computing is via, it takes this input as parameter and it gives this output as a return value. In between, it does not do anything which you can observe, that, you know, in between something has happened. Whereas in this fact with cache, what is happening is that, you know, you provide value of n, it will give value of n factorial, but in between it has a side effect where it is updating this fact cache, and all the fact cache from 1 to n minus 1, in fact even n, is updated. So this fact with cache is not a mathematical function. Why? Because it has a side effect. Instead of just returning the value of n factorial, it is doing things like this. It is updating this cache with some other function. So let's say that, you know, you have some other function. If that guy can actually observe the change in this thing, because you know every function can read this particular global variable and global array, and that is why this is called a side effect, that it leaks this information that you know what is updated, what is not, etc. via this. And this is very, very, so side effect, as much as possible you should try to avoid it. That is why the functional languages are very good at it. They clearly separate that what has a side effect, what does not have a side effect. Languages like, you know, Haskell, and there are other functional programming languages. You know, this is very bad. This becomes in particularly even worse when you are trying to write multi-threaded programs. Why? Because the thing is that while this guy is actually computing, now this information, you know, now because of this side effect, it is, you know, weird things can happen because of this side effect, right? I mean, so because you are updating this information and reading from here, and some other thread and function can also update and read it from here. So a different thread can infect some other function, or running on other thread can also, you know, maybe read and update. That is why global variables are bad, side effects are bad, because analyzing such programs is very difficult, and there can be a lot of interference. You can leak information, somebody can manipulate what you are computing. So this thread might be computing factorial with cache, but somebody else can actually change this value in between, right? And so things like this can happen, and that is kind of bad. So for the sake of completeness, I discussed global variables. So global variables are zero initialized, but you should avoid it as much as possible. You know, if you can finish your entire undergraduate degree without global variables. So the global variables and global scope, your function, so all your functions, right? So even these name of these functions, etc., these are already in global scope. And in C, yeah, that's the way it is, that you know they are in global scope, etc. But you should avoid as much as possible any variable in the global scope. A function, as much as possible, should only interact via the signature, that the input comes here in the parameter and the output goes from here via the return value. That is a good way of programming. You can write correct programs even with this, but this is a very, very bad practice. There are certain usage which are justified, but you know, unless you know what you are doing, unless you become a very experienced programmer, where you know that this is, without this, if I cannot write program, only then you have to write a program with global variables like this. Okay. So we have covered union. We know that, you know, there could be padding in the size of struct, etc. Struct and union, etc., these composite types. We know what is the difference between union and struct. This global scope, you can do memoization. Now you also know side effect. In fact, see, for example, the moment you do any reading or writing to the, so for example, main is never, almost never, right? So the moment you say printf, the function has a side effect. Why? Because you are doing main, it has some input. So right now we haven't talked about what argument it takes, and you are returning, most of the time you are returning this error code of whatever, exit code. So mostly it is zero, which is exit success. But you are also doing printing. The moment you are printing, right, you are printing to standard output, and you are reading from standard input std in. The moment you do that, so these are again, you know, you can leak information and things. So this is in the, so now some another guy also using the standard out and standard in, can observe, because you are changing the status of these streams. You are writing something, you are reading from something for you. So the standard in buffer you are consuming. So some another function or program, etc., can observe the status of std in and std out, and knows that something has changed. So mathematical function does not have this thing. It just input is from here, output is from here, and they don't do anything else. That is a good way of programming. That as much as possible you write mathematical functions. If your functions have side effects, that is bad. Now certainly, right? I mean, if you have to print, you have to print. So I'm not saying that don't print anything. But for most of the other computation, you avoid writing subroutines and start writing mathematical functions. Because functions, once you have functions, function can nicely compose, you can reason about functions. So once you learn about compilers, you will appreciate it more, that why writing computation in a style of mathematical functions is better. Okay, so I hope you understood that why the C in C programming language, when they call functions, they are not mathematical functions, right? Because it can have side effect. We have also discussed in one of the earlier lectures that post increment, pre increment operator, they have side effect. Assignment operator has a side effect. But if you just do addition, that does not have a side effect. So the input comes as operands and there is an output. Okay, so I think we will stop here. Stop a little bit early. So thank you very much. Yeah.